This paragraph, the second paragraph of Nanya, contains the first two answers that Bhagavan gave to the first two questions asked by Shiva Prasham Pillai. Bhagavan has marked his answers in bold type. Well, the first question was Nana, who am I? In case some people get confused about the title of the work, because generally in English it's put that the title is Nanya, but actually the essay form that Bhagavan made and most of the question and answer forms are called Nana. In Tamil, A and Ya both mean who, but after a consonant, A is more, it's more euphonic to say ah, rather than if we say nanya, it sounds like an I sound is added in there, whereas nana is a more euphonic, it flows more naturally in Tamil, so that is why it's called nana. So the first question that Shiva Prasham Pillai asked was nana, who am I? And Bhagavan gave a, at that time, as far as we know, Bhagavan was not talking or talking very little. So most of the answers that Bhagavan gave, he either wrote answers in the sand, or Shiva Prasham Pillai would give him either a slate and chalk and Bhagavan would write on the slate, or he would give him slips of paper and Bhagavan would write on the paper. So most of the replies that Bhagavan gave in Nanya were actually written by him in reply to what Shiva Prasham Pillai asked. So the first question Shiva Prasham Pillai asked was, who am I? And Bhagavan's answer was very simple, Arive Nan. Arive Nan means awareness alone is I. And then Shiva Prasham Pillai asked, what is the swarupa of Arivu? What is the nature of that awareness? And Bhagavan replied, Satchidanandam. All the rest of this paragraph was added by Shiva Prasham Pillai for his own clarification. When Nanya, though this was answers that Bhagavan gave to Shiva Prasham Pillai very, very early on, around about 1901, 1902, Shiva Prasham Pillai noted down Bhagavan's answers in his notebooks, but he never thought of publishing them until 1923, when he wrote a brief biography of Bhagavan in Tamil verse, just one long verse with Bhagavan's biography, in which he included some of the answers, some of the things that Bhagavan had told him at that time. And as an appendix, he selected 13 questions and answers, which he included as an appendix at the end of the book. And that was the first that anyone came to know that Bhagavan had given such answers and that they had been recorded. So very quickly, people started asking, are there more answers that Bhagavan gave to you? So the next version, in Shiva Prasham Pillai, there are many different, he edited it in many different forms, but I think the next version that was published, the first version that was published as a separate work, contained 30 questions and answers, and some miscellaneous sayings towards the end. And because that was so useful, a few years later, Bhagavan, of his own accord, rewrote it as an essay. That was probably around 1926, 27. So anyway, when the manuscript was first brought to Bhagavan by Manikam Pillai, who was a nephew of Shiva Prasham Pillai, and lived with him and sort of looked after him, Bhagavan read it, and when he saw this paragraph, he said, how come all this is here? I didn't say all this. Then Manikam Pillai said, well, Shiva Prasham Pillai added it for his own clarification. He thought it may be useful. And then Bhagavan said, yes, he had studied philosophy, so he would know all these things. So if it's useful for him, it may be useful for others. So Bhagavan retained it, even in the essay, even when he rewrote it in the essay, Bhagavan retained it, but he wrote his own answers in bold type. He marked them in bold type. In the original manuscript, he underlined them in red, and when they were printed, they were printed in bold type. the way the paragraph is now, first comes the first question, who am I? And then comes the bit that Shiv Prakash and Pillai added. The first sentence is, Sapta Dhatu Galahiya Stula Deham Nanandru. That means the stula deha, that's the gross or the physical body, which is formed of sapta dhatus, seven dhatus, is not I. Those dhatus are according child, blood, flesh, fat, bone, marrow, and semen. But they're not enumerated there, he just refers to them. He says sapta dhatu galahiya, that means the body which is formed is implied by these seven constituents. The next sentence is about the five sense organs. That sentence says the five jnanendriyas, which means sense organs, namely ears, skin, eyes, tongue, and nose, which individually and implies respectively, know the five vishayas. Vishayas, there's no exact word in English for vishayas. In many contexts, we can simply translate vishaya as phenomena. But it also means domain. So here it means the kinds of sensory phenomena, namely sound, such, touch. Touch can mean any tactile sensation, like texture and other qualities of touch, well, cold, hot, all these tactile sensations. Form means refers to visual, what we see, the shape and color and other qualities perceived by sight. Taste and smell. So that this all a description of these five jnanendriyas, five sense organs, and they are not I. These five sense organs are not I. The next sentence says a similar thing about the five karmendriyas, which means the organs of action. They are also not I. And they're enumerated, namely mouth, feet or legs, hands or arms, anus and genitals, which respectively do the five actions, namely speaking, going, moving or walking, that is, giving, discharge of feces, and enjoying. Enjoying implies enjoying sexual pleasure. So all these five karmendriyas are not I. And then the next deals with the prana is said to consist of five panchavayus. Panchavayus literally means the five winds or vital airs. It refers to different metabolic processes in the body, not only the breathing, the digestion. I'm not so familiar with all these classifications, but it means all the metabolic processes are classified into five groups: breathing, digestion, heart beat, or whatever. So all these five karmendriyas are also not I. All these five types of prana, five metabolic processes or metabolic forces, or life forces, we can say, are not I. And then the next sentence is a very simple one. Nine kindra manamum nanandru. The mind which thinks is also not I. And then the next, it's going from the grosser to the more and more subtle. The next sentence, sarva vishayangalum, sarva torilgalum atru, vishaya vasane guladun matram, porindi irkum, agnanamum nanandru. What that means is all vishayas, that's all phenomena, and all actions ceasing, as they cease in sleep. In sleep, we're not aware of any phenomena, and we are not engaged in any actions. When all these cease in sleep, what remains is, according to the traditional view, is what remains is ignorance, ajnana. In that context, ajnana means the absence of awareness of phenomena, which is what remains in sleep, which is combined only with vishayavasanas. It's generally said in sleep, what remains is the anandamaya kosha or karana sarira. That is only the very subtle form of the ego, in the form of the karana sarira, remains. This is the traditional explanation given in Vedanta. Bhagavan gives a slightly different explanation, which I'll talk about afterwards. Even this ignorance, which remains in sleep, that is also not I. Why none of these things are I? Because we are there in all the three states. Anything that appears and disappears, anything that exists in one state but not in other states, cannot be what we actually are. Then in the next sentence is Shiv Prakashan Pillai's expansion of Bhagavan's first answer, which, as I said earlier, is Arivainan, awareness alone is I. What he says is, Mel Solia Yabam Nanala Nanala Endru Neti Sedu. That means eliminating or doing neti, rejecting everything mentioned above as not I, not I. Tanitu Nikkum Arivainan. The awareness that remains alone or remains isolated, alone is I. So he's. One thing that Shiv Prakashan Pillai has clarified by adding this is, when Bhagavan says awareness alone is I, we have to understand very clearly what Bhagavan means by that, because Bhagavan clearly distinguished between the awareness that is aware of phenomena, awareness that is aware of anything else, and the simple awareness. In sleep, Bhagavan says, what remains is pure awareness. When we're not aware of anything, that is the state of pure awareness. That is our real nature. That is the awareness that Bhagavan is referring to here. That's why when all these other phenomena which have been discussed above, when they're all set aside as not I, what remains alone, what remains in complete isolation, that pure awareness alone is I, is the implication. And because he asked Bhagavan, what is the nature of that awareness, Bhagavan answered very simply, Satchidanandam. That Bhagavan, Bhagavan later wrote it as an essay, he combined Shiv Prakashan Pillai's question and his answer together as one sentence, Arivin Sarupam Satchidanandam. That means the nature of awareness is Satchidananda. Satchidananda means sat, means in this context, sat is actually a participle that means being or existing, but it also is used as a noun meaning what actually exists, what is real. So what actually exists is sat. Chit is awareness, means more or less the same as arivu. Again, it means pure awareness, not the awareness that is aware of phenomena. And when we remain just as that pure awareness, which we actually are, which is our real nature, sat-chit, what we experience is only ananda. So the nature of that awareness is ananda. It's perfect, pure happiness. As Bhagavan says elsewhere, it's only when the mind rises, but happiness, unhappiness seems to exist. When we remain in our natural state, in sleep, nobody is unhappy in sleep. We're perfectly happy in sleep. It's only when the mind rises that we experience a mixture of pleasure and pain, happiness and unhappiness. What Shiv Prakashan Pillai added here is all a bit technical. And a simpler way of saying this is that the five sheaths are not I. The five she's means the gross body, which is referred to in the first sentence. The prana, that's the life that is animating this body. The mind, the manomaya kosha, the intellect, the vijnanamaya kosha, and what is generally called the anandamaya kosha, also called the karana sarira. It's called the anandamaya kosha because it's said to be what remains alone in sleep. But according, Bhagavan has clarified about this in Uludunapadu, in the fifth verse. He says, Udal Pancha Kosa Uru, the body is a form composed of five sheaves. Therefore, all these fives are included in the term body. Why Bhagavan says that? According to Bhagavan, the nature of the ego is nothing but the false self-awareness, I am this body. We are never aware, we are never aware of anything other than ourself, except when we experience ourselves as a body. Now in the waking state, we take this body as I, and we, through the five senses of this body, we perceive this world. Likewise in sleep, we take a body, we experience a body as I, and through the five senses of that body, we perceive a world. According to Bhagavan, this we all recognize now in the waking state that the body we experience as ourself in sleep was just our own mental projection. According to Bhagavan, this body is no different, because what we are now experiencing as the waking state is actually just another dream. And even when when we're dreaming, we perceive a world, the world we perceive and the body we experience as I all seem to be physical. They all seem to be, it seems to be real so long as we're experiencing the dream. If we're in a very dangerous situation, the danger seems to us to be very, very real. If we're balancing on the edge of a cliff or something, we're really genuinely afraid of falling. We may tell, even if we think, oh no, this is just a dream, still, that's just a thought. To us, the whole situation seems completely real at that time. Why it seems to be real? Because we experience that body in dream as ourself, because we are real, that body seems to us to be real, because we experience it as ourself. And because the body seems to be real, the body is part of we experience the body as being part of a whole world, the whole world seems to be real. So the reality we perceive in the world, the reality we perceive in the body, is our own reality, which we have superimposed upon them by taking the body to be I. So whatever state we may be in, what we perceive in that state seems to be real. When we leave that state and go to another similar state, we say about the previous state, oh, that was just a dream, it was just my imagination. This is the real state. Bhagavan says this is no more real than dream. When we're dreaming, that seems to be the real state. If we were having this discussion in a dream, we'd be referring to our then state as if it was a waking state, because that's what it would seem to be. So the normal explanation given in Advaita philosophy is that the body we experience as ourself in the waking state is the stula deha, the gross body. The body we experience as ourself in sleep, in dream, is sukshma deha, the subtle body. And the body we experience, and what we experience, the ignorance that we experience in sleep, is the causal body. And that causal body is formed only of the vasanas, the vishaya vasanas, the liking to be aware of things other than ourselves, which remain in seed form in sleep. According to Bhagavan, this is not a correct explanation. Sometimes when talking to people who were soaked in this way of viewing, Bhagavan would sometimes answer as if he was accepting this view. But he made it very, very clear elsewhere that the body we experience as ourselves in dream, now we say it's a subtle body, but while we're dreaming, it seems to us to be a gross body, it seems to be a physical body. And according to Bhagavan, what all these five sheaves, they're not covering our real self. They're sheaves which come along with the ego. The ego covers itself. If you remove the sheaves, then the ego dissolves back into its source. But the pure awareness is never covered by anything, because in its view, there's nothing other than itself. So all these five sheaves, they come into existence along with the ego, and they disappear along with the ego. Because the ego subsides in sleep, there are none of these five sheaves there. That's why Bhagavan said all these five sheaves collectively are what is called body. So when Bhagavan says the ego is nothing but the false self-awareness, I am this body, we never experience a dead body as ourself. When we experience a body as ourself, that body always seems to be living. So there's a gross body and the prana, the life is there. So we never experience these two separately. We also, when we are experiencing a body as ourself, we seem to be awake. So, or dreaming, when we're looking at it from outside that state. So mind is functioning and intellect is functioning. So four sheaves are always, these four sheaves always come together. We never experience the mind without a gross body. We never experience a mind without a living gross body. So these four sheaves always exist together. And the basic darkness of self-ignorance in which all these things appear, that is the causal body, which is the most subtle form of the ego. It is the basic self-ignorance, because the ego couldn't rise. The ego is a false self-awareness. So the false self-awareness is a type of darkness. It cannot exist without that basic darkness, without that basic self-ignorance. So according to Bhagavan, all these five sheaths, they appear along with the ego and they disappear along with the ego. So in waking and dream, all five sheaths are present. In sleep, none of these are present. All that we experience in sleep is just pure self-awareness. It's only from the perspective of the ego in waking or dream that sleep seems to be a state of darkness. Because what we experience in sleep is pure self-awareness. Even now we're experiencing that pure self-awareness, but as this ego, we experience that pure self-awareness mixed with awareness of body. So because we cannot distinguish the pure self-awareness now from the perspective of this ego, which is never able to distinguish that pure self-awareness, sleep seems to be, in which pure self-awareness alone exists, seems to be a state of darkness. Because we're not aware of anything in sleep. So in the view of the ego, it seems to be a state of darkness. Bhagavan says, actually, it's a state of pure awareness. And we can understand this from our own experience. If we apply a little logic, we're all clearly aware that we slept. We're all clearly aware that if sleep was a state of total non-awareness, we would be aware of only two states. Waking and dream, just coming one after another. But we're clearly aware of a gap between these states. There's a third state in which we are not aware of anything. The fact that we're aware of that third state in which we're not aware of anything means we were aware in that state, but we weren't aware of anything. We were in that state, we existed just as pure awareness. And that pure awareness, according to Bhagavan, is our real nature. So that's one way in which this is analyzed. Shiv Prakashan Pillai gives a slightly more technical analysis here. This is because all these things that he lists here, the reason these are mentioned in Advaita philosophy, none of these are necessary to Advaita philosophy. As Bhagavan says in a later paragraph in Nanya, just like in a barber shop, you have to sweep up all the rubbish and discard it. You don't analyze the grey hairs and the black hairs and the white and the red hairs. You don't analyze, but it's all rubbish. It's all to be discarded. Like that, we don't have to analyze all these tattvas. But most philosophies are outward looking. So they see the manifest world and they classify it in so many ways. In ancient India, there were so many different philosophies were competing with each other. Both philosophies were classified into two groups, the Astika ones, the ones that accepted the Vedas, and both that didn't accept the Vedas, the Nastika ones. The Nastika ones were Buddhism, the various schools of Buddhism, Jainism, and materialism. And the Astika ones were Vedanta, Sankhya, and there were six of them. So there were so many different schools of philosophy. So when they were all competing. The adherents of each type of philosophy were trying to put forward their own philosophy as this is the right philosophy. So they engage in arguments with other types of philosophy. So because Advaita had to contend with so many other philosophies, a lot of those other the concepts from those other systems of philosophy found a place in Advaita. So all this type of classification, which is really not necessary, because what he's saying in all these paragraphs is these are not I. If they're not I, why to analyze them in so much detail? But a lot of Advaita philosophy goes into this analysis because they had to answer other systems of philosophy. So we can see Shiv Prakashan Pillai, when he was studying at college, he had studied Indian philosophy, so he'd learnt all this. So when Bhagavan's answer was extremely, extremely simple, but for him to help him to understand it, he related it to all the philosophy that he'd learnt when he was at college. So we don't have to, but a lot of detail here is not important for us. The main point is, to put it in the simplest possible terms, whatever appears obviously disappears, and whatever appears and disappears cannot be ourself, because we are aware of the appearance of these things and the disappearance of these things, and the root of all things that appear and disappear is the ego. As Bhagavan says in verse 26 of Uludhanapu, when the ego comes into existence, everything comes into existence. Everything in there means all phenomena, all physical phenomena, material, mental phenomena, all everything other than ourself. It all comes into existence only when the ego comes into existence. When the ego doesn't exist, everything doesn't exist. Nothing else exists. Therefore, Bhagavan said the ego is everything. The ego is the seed that expands as all this. The ego is the, another way you can explain, the ego is the perceiving element of the mind. Generally, when we use the term mind, we use it as a collective term for all the thoughts, all mental phenomena we take as mind. But among all these mental phenomena, there's a perceiver. That perceiving element of the mind is the ego. So Bhagavan says the ego is the root of the mind and it's the essence of the mind. So often when Bhagavan's using the term mind, he's actually referring just to the ego, because according to Bhagavan, that is the essence of the mind. So the ego expands as the mind, all the phenomena that constitute, and according to Bhagavan, nothing exists independent of the mind. The whole world, according to Bhagavan, is nothing but thought. We take all these to be physical phenomena, this chair, this carpet, this wall, these all seem to us to be physical phenomena. According to Bhagavan, they're all thoughts, that they're all mental phenomena. They're all our own mental projection. When we're dreaming, we see so many what seem to be so many physical phenomena. We see a physical world, we see people, all these things, but it all seems to be physical so long as we're dreaming. But when we wake up, we recognize it was all our own mental projection. According to Bhagavan, all this is our mental projection. So all that we see is nothing but our own thoughts. So everything, all phenomena are mental phenomena. And these mental phenomena are just, they're projected by the ego, they're an expansion of the ego. So the substance of which this whole world is made is the ego. and the substance of which the ego, what is the ultimate substance, that is the pure self-awareness which we actually are. So I was saying about the, when Bhagavan says that awareness alone is I, we should be very clear about what he means. In Uddhanapati, he's very, very clearly distinguished the real awareness from the awareness that appears and disappears, the awareness that is aware of things other than ourselves. That is, the awareness that is aware of other things is the mind. That is a false awareness, according to Bhagavan. What is real in the mind is only the pure self-awareness. But when we rise as the mind or ego, we rise as I am this body, I am this person. And that is that false self-awareness expands as all these phenomena. So Bhagavan's metaphysics are extremely, extremely simple. And Bhagavan has, if you read Advaita philosophy, you can get yourself bogged down in so much detail. But Bhagavan has cast aside most of the unnecessary detail, and he's given us the very essence of Advaita, which is the root of everything is the ego. Because the ego rises, everything else seems to exist. The ego, why does the ego seem to exist? Because of pramada, because we are not sufficiently self-attentive, because we're more interested in attending to things other than ourselves. As soon as we attend to something other than ourselves, we seem to be something other, so we've limited ourselves as this person. The way to get rid of this ego, because it's a false self-awareness, it will be dissolved only by pure self-awareness. So it's only by attending to ourself alone that we can eradicate this ego. So the outward-facing mind becomes all this. In Day by Day, in a couple of places, Bhagavan says, someone asks something to the effect, what's the difference between the mind and self, or mind and pure awareness? Bhagavan said, when outward facing is called mind, when the same awareness is facing itself, it is called pure self-awareness or self, Atman, whatever. So it's so simple. But the choice is ours. Do we choose to face outwards or do we choose to face inwards? Well, unfortunately, the reason we're all here is because we're still making the wrong choice. We're still facing outwards. But slowly, 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 if we really want to follow Bhagavan's path, we have to cultivate that habit of looking within, turning within. As Bhagavan says in one verse in Aksharamlai, Tirumbiyahan dane dinamaha kankan teriyam andranayan Arunachala. Oh Arunachala, what a wonder. You said to me, turning within daily. Daily means perpetually, constantly. Turning within constantly. See yourself with the inner eye. The inner eye means the introverted attention. The self-attentiveness. It will be known, teriyam. So that's all that verse contains Bhagavan's whole philosophy in a nutshell. That's what Arunachala taught Bhagavan in silence, and Bhagavan taught us in words. So though I go on and on talking about Bhagavan's teachings, it's so many words are not really necessary. The words seem to be necessary because we, in spite of hearing this, our mind keeps on going outwards. So we need to be dwelling upon Bhagavan's words to constantly remind ourselves to turn within. Other than that, no words are necessary. Ultimately, we just have to come to that state of just being as we actually are, which means being pure self-awareness, which entails attending to ourselves, which is the path of Atmavichara that Bhagavan taught us. It's all so simple.
Is ego the same as the I thought?
Yes, very clearly. Very clearly Bhagavan says, here in the eighth paragraph of Nanya. Nineve manatin sarupam. Thought alone is the nature of the mind. Nanenum ninevu, the thought called I, manatin mudal ninevu. The thought called I is the first thought of the mind. Aduve ahankaram. That alone is ego. So what Bhagavan, when Bhagavan talks about the thought called I, he's it's another term for the ego.
Before we have any more questions, I think we should have some silence, if you finish.
Okay, yes.
10 minutes silence.
The inquiry sounds like one seeking to know something, but it also sounds like, from what you're saying, that it isn't an object to be known. So what in sense... In what sense do you get to know the self?
We are seeking to know clearly what we know already. Mm. We already know I am. Mm. We know the fact that I am. Mm. But we don't clearly know what I am. So we're trying to get what is called self-knowledge or self-realization or whatever, it's just a clarity of self-awareness.
So it's a dispelling thing.
It's a dispelling, exactly. According to Bhagavan, if Atmajnana was something to be gained, to be attained in future, whatever comes will have to go. So such Atmajnana or such liberation would be of no use. If liberation isn't here and now, if Atmajnana isn't here and now, an Atmajnana that comes in future will come and it will go. So what we are seeking is not some new experience, but what is always present, what we are always aware of. So Atmajnana is not a new knowledge. It is not an addition, it is a subtraction.
It's a clarity.
And that clarity, all that is required for that clarity, is removing the lack of clarity. And the root of the lack of clarity is the ego. So remove the ego, and what remains is clarity. So as Bhagavan often emphasized, there's nothing to be gained, just everything has to be lost. When everything is lost, along with its root, the ego, what remains is what is always there, what you always are.
I've one other question.
Yes.
When you talked about the dream, this being a dream,
yes,
and dreaming being a dream,
yes,
being the same, that's a kind of solipsism, isn't it?
It is a solipsism, but there's a difference between the solipsism taught by Bhagavan and the solipsism that philosophers generally are very, very wary of. Because the general understanding of solipsism is that the ego alone exists. But according to Bhagavan, there is only one ego, but that one ego doesn't really exist. It merely seems to exist. So if we investigate who is this one I who perceives all this, what remains is our real nature, which is the infinite whole. So actually, we are not excluding everything. We, in a sense, we're embracing everything. By rejecting everything, we're embracing everything. We're rejecting the outward appearance and embracing the inward inner substance. But so long as we seem to be this person, all the other people who seem to exist are as real as ourselves. Bhagavan doesn't say there's only one person, he said there's one ego. So long as that one ego The ego always takes itself to be a person, and because it takes itself to be a person, all the other persons it sees, it takes to be egos. For all practical purposes, that's all mundane purposes, the other people are as real as we are. Because even now you take your, sorry, may I know your name?
Ken.
Ken. Now you feel I am Ken. Ken is no more real than any of the other people in this room. So Bhagavan isn't saying Ken alone is real. He's saying, he isn't saying Ken is the only person. He's saying the I that says I am Ken, that is the only I. If you know the real nature of that I, the I that says I am Ken is the ego. But if the ego who says I am Ken investigates itself to find out what it really is, that is the real I, which is what shines equally in all, because that alone exists. That is the one's real substance.
I think the term ego, the word ego,
yes,
perhaps doesn't convey exactly what is intended, because in English, ego has a derivative connotation. Ego is something that you should not have.
Yes.
That person has a lot of ego. That means
yes.
Not to be taken seriously.
Yes.
So ego has a pejorative meaning in English.
But yes.
The actual word that is used is ahankara. Ahankara means that which creates the feeling of I-ness in me.
Yes.
That which creates the feeling of I-ness in me.
Yes.
I am separate from others.
Yes.
That everyone has that.
Yes.
So that is not something that is pejorative. So ego doesn't convey exactly what is meant by ahankara.
The same words are used in different contexts in different sense. Obviously, when Bhagavan talks about ego, he's not, for example, talking about a Freudian ego. But the term Bhagavan actually generally uses in Tamil. Sometimes he uses ahankaram, but more frequently he uses the word ahande, which is a Tamil form of the Sanskrit term ahanta. A hunter means the I-ness. Ego, actually, all ego means, ego is a Latin word that means I. So we have to understand the sense in which words are used. The same word, consciousness or awareness, is used in so many different ways. People go out to raise awareness poverty or something. That's not the awareness that Bhagavan is talking about. When Bhagavan talks about awareness or consciousness, he's talking about that which is aware, that which is conscious. Now, what is conscious of other things is the ego or mind. But that is, according to Bhagavan, that is not the real consciousness. That which is, the real consciousness is only that which is awareness of anything is not real awareness. Only awareness is real awareness. That's a pure awareness. Where objectless, people use so many terms, objectless awareness, contentless awareness, we can say. In other words, the pure self-awareness. Prajnanam, yes. That prajnanam is not aware of anything except itself. But itself is not an object. We cannot be aware without being aware that we're aware. So by being aware that I am aware, I'm aware of I. But I is not an object of my awareness. I is that which is aware. So it is perfect non-duality, otherlessness.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Bhagavan give any best method for fixing your consciousness, for fixing your attention on your inner?
Bhagavan gave us many clues to help us turn our attention back to ourself. But when people ask how to do it, he said if the way were objective, it could be shown by another. The way is subjective.
I was meaning is our way of fixing it subjectively when you get to that.
Yeah, the term Bhagavan used in Sanskrit, the Sanskrit term he often used was Atmavichara. The Tamil term, equivalent Tamil term, is Tannatam. Both of them mean self-investigation. This is a path of investigation. What is, if we knew what is perfect self-attention, the ego would dissolve. The whole, we practice self-attention in order to learn what is pure self-attention. Just like how to learn how to ride a bicycle. The only way to learn to ride a bicycle, you can read volumes of physics and about center of gravity and about balance and so many things, and you can read about the mechanics of a cycle. However much you read, you cannot learn to cycle without actually getting on a cycle and trying. It's exactly the same with this. We want to know what is pure self-awareness. The only way to know what is pure self-awareness is to try to be aware of ourself alone, to attend to ourself alone. But this is an infallible path, because to express it another way, we are turning our attention back towards the light that illumines all this. By what is the light that illumines all this? Okay, physical light is enabling our eyes to see. But there's a subtler light than the physical light. Because even when the physical light is off, we can still hear things, we can touch things. There's something, some other inner light, that is the light of awareness, that enables us to be aware of all these things. So when we are turning our attention back towards the light. So whereas any other path, we can be misled, we can go in the wrong direction. When we're turning towards the light will unfailingly guide us. That is why Bhagavan said, the real guru is your own self. By turning with how to contact the inner guru, you are the inner guru. By facing yourself, by turning towards yourself, you are contacting the inner guru. And the inner guru teaches through silence. And the only way to understand the teaching of the inner guru is to be silent. And we can be silent only by facing within.
I just wondering if there might be a way you can kind of sucker it, so you can really stop the mind wandering.
The only way to stop the mind wandering is to love to be aware of yourself. That is why Bhagavan often said, bhakti is the mother of jnana, love. It's all a matter of love. Why we could realize ourselves at this very moment if we wanted to. Why none of us here, why we're all still in ignorance? Because we don't yet have sufficient love to know ourselves. Because we've got so much attachment to other things, we're not ready to let go. We're not ready to pay the price. So what is required, the two wings on which we fly to liberation, are bhakti and vairagya. Vairagya is the freedom from desire or attachment for other things. Bhakti is the love to know ourselves. There is no shortcut. But no shortcut is necessary, because what we're seeking is here and now. It's ever available to us.
Another point that you raised that intrigued me is that when you said, Bhagavan got taught by the mountain in silence.
Yes.
And you spoke it to us.
Yes.
Is there any, I know this is perhaps another point.
Yes.
Going back into what we shouldn't be, but I'm very intrigued about what the constitution of the mountain is. Who or what and why did Arunachala teach Bhagavan?
Bhagavan has said, Arunachala is I. If you want to know the secret of Arunachala, you know the secret of I. So long as we look outwards and see a mountain, we are not seeing Arunachala as it is. That outward form, just like the outward form of Bhagavan, for us is indispensable, because if Bhagavan hadn't appeared in this outward form, there'd be no one to tell us to turn within. So the outward form has a purpose, But the output form is, Bhagavan is not this form. Arunachal is not this mountain. Arunachal is what is shining in his eye. But what this mountain represents, the mountain is an embodiment of silence. And since Bhagavan's real teaching is silence, Bhagavan and Arunachal are inseparable. I wish I could be. Being quiet is the greatest thing of all.
Michael?
Yes.
I'm a bit puzzled by something you're saying about how all phenomena that apparently are created by the ego. So I'm sure we're all aware of what's in this room.
Yes.
So the chairs and the people and the windows, etc. Are we all individually projecting that, or is it just a coincidence?
The one who is seeing it is projecting it. The one who is perceiving it is projecting it. So how many perceivers are in this room?
Well, I guess it's always answering that.
All the other perceivers exist in your view. That's why he asked the question about solipsism. Yes. In Indian philosophy, solipsism is called ekajivavada. Ekajivavada means one jiva, one ego. That is what Bhagavan taught us.
Yes.
He's not saying, as I say, so long as we look outwards, there are many people. Those people are as real as the person we seem to be. So it's not, Bhagavan isn't recommending selfish behavior or anything. In fact, if we behave selfishly, it's because we take this person to be I, and this person is more important than that person, because this person is me. We need to dissolve this feeling of separation between ourselves and others. So it's a very, very subtle thing. Why Bhagavan taught us this ekajivavada? Because it's for in order to turn us within. Because there's one ego that has risen and has projected all this. The ego that has projected is the ego that is seeing it. Who is this ego? Who am I? To turn our attention back to investigate this, Bhagavan said all this. But when we are facing outwards, we have to act as if all this is real.
So there are maybe 20, 30 other people in this room.
Yes.
Is that just one ego creating all this?
One ego, yes, and that ego is you. When Bhagavan was talking about ekajivavada, and there was a small group of people there, and someone asked, then Bhagavan, which among all of us here is the one ego? Bhagavan said, you are that. Then someone else said, Bhagavan, what about me? Bhagavan said, you are that. But the one ego knows who it is. The one who is seeing all this, that is the one ego.
I still don't understand the difference between my apparent ego and other people's ego.
But isn't your experience of your ego slightly different? The other people's egos is an inference. Because you experience yourself now as a person. Because you who experience yourself as this person are the ego. Because this ego experiences itself as a person, when it sees other persons, it assumes there's an ego in every other person. But that is only an assumption. You can only see the world from the point of view of your own ego.
Isn't something, okay, so you're going to get confused with Freudian terminology, isn't it? Yeah. As it were, superego. I don't mean the superego people, it's what I talk about projecting the whole world, each of us individually.
Some people believe that, yes. Major Chadwick, for example, he had a lot of difficulty understanding this, so he asked Bhagavan, isn't there a cosmic mind that has projected all this? And is that cosmic mind the same as God? Bhagavan said, in whose view, who is it who's asking about the cosmic mind? Find out about that mind first, and then come back to me if you still find, once you find out what this mind is, if you still think there may be a cosmic mind, then come back and ask me. We can believe anything, but the thing is, if Bhagavan always asks us, don't believe what you don't know. Now we are aware of only one awareness. We infer that all these other people are aware, but actually I am aware of only one awareness, that's my own awareness. So long as I'm interacting with the world, I must obviously interact with other people as if all this is real. But it's meaningless not to. You know why? Because the one who is interacting is this person. And this person is no more real than any of the other people. So at the level that we are this person, we have to behave as if all this is real. But if we're content with this state, Bhagavan doesn't disturb us. But if we want to know what is beyond all this, Bhagavan said, you have to turn within and find it within yourself. But the purposes of our turning within, Bhagavan said, all this appears only when you appear. You are the root of all this. You are the cause of all this.
But who is it that turns within, isn't it?
It's the ego.
Right. So
but when the ego succeeds in turning within, it ceases to be ego. It's ego only so long as it's turning outwards. That's why Bhagavan sometimes said, the same mind when facing outwards is called mind, the same mind when facing back inwards is called self or pure self-awareness. There is only one. Now the one that seems to be the ego, but if the ego investigates itself, it will find it was never ego, it was always just pure and infinite self-awareness.
But you can get into a situation where you say, well, I've got to wrestle with my ego, bring it down. It's an ego fighting.
Yeah, we can seem to get in, but that is not the way, because fighting with the ego, but the ego is something to fight with only when it's facing outwards. Bhagavan says, don't fight with the ego. There's a Puranic story Bhagavan used to say to illustrate this. That is, after, I don't know if you know the story of Rama's life, but Rama's wife Sita had been kidnapped by Ravana and taken away to Lanka. So Rama had to go and bring her back. And for that he needed an army. So he was gathering support. And he came to the kingdom of the monkeys. And the rightful king of the monkeys was Sugriva. But his elder brother had usurped the throne. I mean, his younger brother, I think, had usurped the throne. His brother was Vali. And how Vali was able to gain the power from his brother was because he had done some tapas and he had got a boon. The boon he had asked for and he had been granted by some god was that whoever he faces in battle, half of that person's strength should go to him. So he's unfailingly more powerful than anyone he faces. So Sugriva could never defeat him. Sugriva asked Rama for help. And not only had Vali taken Sugriva's kingdom, he'd also stolen his wife. So Sugriva was very much in the same position as Rama. So Rama saw the injustice and he agreed, I will kill Vali. But I cannot face Vali in battle because I know if I face him, he'll get half my strength and he'll defeat me. So it's only by trickery that we can. So he told Sugriva, you go out and challenge him to battle. And Sugriva went and challenged him to battle and he was beaten back, and he told Rama, why you didn't do anything? Rama said, no, you go and challenge him again. And on the third or fourth time, Rama was hiding behind a tree, and finally he took the opportunity, he shot Vali from behind. And people say, oh, how Rama could shoot, that's against the warrior's code to shoot someone from behind. But that was the only way of defeating him. And when he shot him, Vali was lying there dying, and he questioned Rama, how could you do this? He said, well, it was the only way. What you're doing is injustice. This was the only way to rectify the injustice. And he said, well, why didn't you ask for my help? I could easily go and defeat Ravana and bring back Sita. And Rama said, how can I ask for your help? You've stolen your own brother's wife. How can I ask your help to go and bring back my wife? That's a story. But what Bhagavan used to say, the ego or mind is like Vali. If we face it in battle, we'll be defeated, because we, by our trying to conquer the mind, by our trying to conquer the ego, we're giving half our strength to it, because the ego thrives on the attention we give it. So the only way, just like Rama had to shoot Vali from behind, we have to kill this ego surreptitiously by turning our attention back within. So the only way to defeat the ego is not no yoga or tapas or anything is a means to defeat the ego, because any yoga or tapas entails the ego to do it. So the only way to destroy the ego is to turn it within, turn it back to its source.
Why there is seemingly a multitude of egos in front of us instead of just one.
Mm.
What exactly did Bhagavan say to him?
I can't remember. I think there's, if I remember correctly, there's something in talks, and also I think Chadwick also recorded something. But I mean, I think all I can remember is that Chadwick had this idea about universal cosmic mind, I think he called it.
Right.
And Bhagavan said, in whose view does the cosmic mind exist, or something to, there's only one mind that is seeing all this.
Oh, I see.
That is the mind that is, the same mind that is dreaming the dream is the mind that has projected the dream.
Yes. He was also puzzled about the difference between waking consciousness and dream consciousness, wasn't he?
I think probably, yeah. I mean, many people were. What Bhagavan has taught us is very simple to understand, but for many people it's very difficult to accept. Because our minds are so steeped in the idea that I am this body and this world is real. Even if we are ready to accept theoretically that the body is not I, but we're something more than the body, to accept that the world is just a dream, it's just our own mental projection,
yes,
and that therefore we are the only one seeing it, it's not an easy thing for people to accept.
It's not, it's very, very difficult.
Yeah. But in order to follow Bhagavan's path, we have to have complete vairagya, complete willingness to let go of everything. And so the first thing we have to let go of is our beliefs about things.
Yes.
Some people take Bhagavan's path to be some sort of a... In some people's mind, Bhagavan is associated with religion. But there's a fundamental difference between what generally people understand by religion and Bhagavan's path. Generally, religion is about belief, about faith. accepting certain things. Whereas Bhagavan's path is a path of radical skepticism. Bhagavan asks us to question all our beliefs, even our most fundamental belief is all, is I am this body. I mean, it's actually it's not just a belief, it's our experience. We all experience the body as I. And because we experience the body as I, we experience the world as if it's real. It seems to us to be real. Bhagavan has asked us to question all these beliefs, not to take these beliefs at face value.
And yet he does teach us certain things, doesn't he? For example, he tells us that if you catch hold of the I thought until it disappears, then something else appears to take its place, which is the real I.
Well, yeah, I mean, Bhagavan expressed the same thing in different ways at different times. But the thing is, the context in which he said that is all the effort we can make is to turn the mind within. What happens beyond that is not in the hands of the ego, because by turning our mind within, we are actually surrendering the ego. The actual destruction of the ego is when we surrender the ego by turning it within, the ego subsides, and then what shines forth is a perfect clarity of pure self-awareness, which is always there. It's not something new. But from the perspective of the ego, it seems something new. But when it shines forth, the ego is swallowed. So in order to help people to understand this, Bhagavan sometimes said it in... A lot of what Bhagavan has said is metaphorical, because the truth is beyond words, it's beyond thoughts. Yes. So often metaphor is the best way of, not of expressing it, but it can't be expressed, but metaphor is the best way of pointing towards it. Yes. So a lot of things Bhagavan has said, people often give an overly literal interpretation to what Bhagavan said. But we have to go beyond the literal meaning of what he said to understand what he's pointing at. There is nothing that is going to come and rise and swallow us. That's all. It's all metaphorical, because what is there is always there, and it doesn't do anything. The nature of self-awareness is just pure being. It's not doing. Self-awareness never does anything. But the very nature of self-awareness is the love itself. And that love manifests as grace. So we talk about the action of grace. Even Bhagavan talks about the action. In the first verse of Arunachashtakam, he says it stands as if an insentient hill, a hill without any awareness, but its action, he uses the word in Tamil, sail. I didn't sail, very, very dark, and nobody, it cannot be understood by anyone. Yeah. Because it's not that Arunachal is actually doing anything. All Arunachal is doing is just being.
Yes.
Being the pure self-awareness that it actually is. But by its mere being, from the ego's perspective, it seems to be the act of grace. Yes. Bhagavan gives a very explains it very nicely in the 15th paragraph of Nanya, I think, where he says, just like all the actions that happen in, just like the sun rises without any volition or intention, but in its mere presence, all the activities on earth take place. So also God has no intention, no sankalpa, no will of his own. But by his mere presence, all these creation, sustenance, dissolution, all are happening by sannidhi visesha matrata. That means by the mere presence of God, by the mere specialness of his presence. So Bhagavan actually doesn't do anything. Bhagavan just is. But by his just being, he's doing everything, or everything is being done. So, but when he talked of some power rising from within, that is a metaphorical way of putting it. When the ego turns within to face the source of all light, the source from which the ego itself arises, the ego is a false awareness, but the original awareness from which it arises, the original light from which it arises, it is swallowed by that light. When it is swallowed by that light, it is metaphorically said that light rises and swallows it. That's like saying, being overwhelmed by grace. It's not that grace comes and, it's not a big wave that comes and overwhelms us. It's, we can only describe these, we can only express these things in metaphors.
Yes, I understand. Another thing I noticed in what you said at the beginning was that you talked about the two wings on which we fly to self-realization.
Yes.
As being love or devotion on the one hand and vairagya.
Yes. But they're inseparable. Because the more you love to know yourself, the less you will have desire or attachment for other things.
Yes, I understand that.
Yes.
But it's normally put that it's love and devotion on the one hand and self-inquiry on the other, which is slightly different to vairagya.
No, well, according to Bhagavan, it's not. Bhagavan defines vairagya in Nanya. He says not attending to anything else is vairagya.
So I suppose in that sense it does mean the same.
Anyate, where is it? Let me see. Anyate nada dirutal vairagyam aljunirase. That is, not attending to anything other, that means other than oneself, is vairagya or desirelessness. And then in the next sentence he says, with the stone of that vairagya, we have to dive deep within ourselves. So long as we have attachment to other things, so long as we have desire for other things, so long as we have a taste for anything other than ourselves, we're not able to go deep enough within, because we're not ready to let go. So vairagya is absolutely essential. But vairagya and bhakti, they're two sides of the same coin.
Yes, I understand.
Yeah.
I find that quite helpful, actually, because I've never had heard it.
But self-inquiry is the practice of bhakti and vairagya.
Yeah. I mean,
the practical application of it.
I mean, essentially, self-inquiry and vairagya are one and the same thing.
And bhakti Bhagavan talks about when he said bhakti is the mother of jnana, it's the love to know oneself. Yeah. So when we put that love into practice, that is self-investigation. I'm a vichara.
Okay.
But we can put it into practice effectively only to the extent that we have love and bhakti and vairagya.
Thank you.
Again, it's when we talk about the two wings, often bhakti and vairagya are described as two wings.
Yes.
It's an analogy. It's pointing at something beyond what it is.
Yes, I understand.
Yeah, yeah.
I just never heard it put in the and bhakti on the other.
Yeah, yeah.
But they do amount to the same thing.
Yeah.
Another thing that Bhagavan said about Arunachala was in the Ashtakam.
Yes.
When he first came up to the mountain, he realized that it actually represented perfect stillness.
Yes.
Absolute stillness.
Yes.
His word.
Well, he said, Achala Makandain. I saw it standing, Achala. Achala has two meanings. One meaning of Achala, Chala means movement. Achala means unmoving. Because Achala means unmoving, it's also used as a name for a hill, because a hill is unmoving. So particularly in Arunachala Stuti Panchakam, a lot of what Bhagavan says has double meaning. So Achala Makandain can mean I saw it as a hill. It can also mean I saw it as the unmovable reality. But then he says that the very next verse is very, very important, the second verse. That is, he ends the first verse by saying, I saw it standing at Chilla. And then the next verse he describes the practice of self-investigation. When I looked within to see who is the seer, I saw what remained when the seer became non-existent. But then even that is not a proper way of expressing it. Bhagavan himself he almost corrects himself there, because he says, I saw, but then he says, the mind doesn't rise to say I saw. How can it rise to say I didn't see? Because, I mean, words cannot express it. Bhagavan is expressing the inexpressible and then saying, it's the wrong way of saying it, because it can't be said correctly. But very, very, very deep, deep clues. This Arunachi Ashtagam is a very, very important work.
Yes, it is. It's a very beautiful work.
Yes, very.
It's often occurred to me that that's one of the... your question, I think you were wondering what the special power of Arunachala is. And it has occurred to me, often I've sort of walked up from the ashram to Skanda ashram, and it varies very much according to the amount of noise that you get from the town below. There are some pockets on the way up in which there is perfect stillness. Even now, it's absolutely still, but it doesn't last for very long.
However much noise there is below, the stillness remains there. It's our view of it is changing.
Yes, I know, but the racket doesn't actually help.
Yes.
When you sort of get over the brow of the hill and you get all the noise coming up from the town, it's
yes.
Murderous.
Yes.
There's no way to call it a peaceful yes. hill with all that racket playing on. But there are places in which it is very still.
Looking down at the temple as well.
Pardon?
Looking down at the temple.
Yeah.
That to me looks like a divine... piece of architecture,
temple that's there, that's like some sort of symbol of divinity in itself.
Yes.
Yes, it's true. It's very impressive because you sort of get over the brow of the hill and you look down, there's this massive structure below you.
Yeah.
Yes, it is amazing.
Beautiful.
I have a question for you. If the practice is self-inquiry, is the eradication of the I thought.
Mm-hmm.
What essentially happens to thinking and thought in the mind? Does it just disappear? And what happens if you, say, doing intellectual work, you're sort of a writer, or you're preparing for your presentation? How do you do that if your practice is self-inquiry and you therefore lose the inclination to have a mental commentary
right.
on what you're doing?
Well, whatever work we may be doing, whether it's physical work or mental work, we are always aware that I am. Most of the time, we are more interested in what's going on outside than in just being aware of I am. So we are slowly, cultivating a love to be aware just of I am. It is possible even in the midst of other things, if the love is there. For example, supposing some very, very dear friend of yours had a car accident and was in hospital. They're in intensive care and the doctors have said it's touch and go. They may survive, they may not survive. Even when you're at work, whatever you may be doing, will not the thought of your friend be constantly at the background of your mind? It doesn't mean you can't do your work. You can drive your car, you can go to work, you can do all that is there. But constantly in the background of your mind, that thought of your friend is there. Likewise, if we are so passionate, just like we are so interested in our friend surviving, we care so much for us, friends surviving. If we care so much to know ourselves, That self-awareness will be constantly aware of ourselves in the background, whatever else we may be doing.
I understand that, and I appreciate it. It's an excellent analogy. But I think there is an understanding that perhaps realization, enlightenment, whatever you want to call it, is a thoughtless state.
Yes.
And that the mind will become peaceful like a lake, for example, with no disturbance.
Yes.
So if you are effectively engaging in mental work, which most of us have to do.
Yes.
It sort of strikes me as a sort of paradox there, that it's not really possible to do that effectively because the mind is so disintegrated that even thought form of word, even speaking, actually becomes an anathema to just wanting to rest in silence or the being of oneself.
Did Bhagavan do any work?
Well, he did physical work, didn't he? He worked in the kitchen.
Yes.
He didn't speak much.
He wrote all this book. Not all his original writing. His original writings forms only a small portion of this book, but he translated a lot of works from Sanskrit into Tamil. He definitely did mental work. That is, when I say he, I'm talking about this person who we take to be Bhagavan.
Yes.
But Bhagavan himself says, what is the state of vijnani? Vijnani, Bhagavan compares to a person sleeping in a cart. If a person is sleeping in a bullock cart, they're not aware whether the bullock cart is moving, whether the bullocks are standing, or whether the bullocks are unyoked. He's happily sleeping there. So Bhagavan says, so is vijnani, sleeping in the body, unaware of its activity, or its sleep, or its nishta. Nishta means like when it's in a state like samadhi. So Bhagavan wasn't, the real Bhagavan wasn't aware of this body at all. But in our view, this body seems to be Bhagavan. So.
Yeah, I can see what you're saying. I just find in my own experience, like if you're say you create something with your hands or you paint or whatever, there is an expression of yourself which is wordless, effortless, and it just unfolds beautifully in creation.
Yeah.
If you're writing something, that, you know, I'm sure people here write all day, I do myself, it strikes me that the working surface is so close to that I thought that it becomes very difficult to disengage. And the mind, the stream of thinking, of doing the work in one's mind, actually impedes the inquiry. Whereas outward work, painting, for example, it's much more satisfying.
Right. Okay. Firstly, we have to distinguish between practice and the final attainment, because when you were talking about when the you said when the I thought is dissolved, the mind is peaceful like a lake. That is not true. When the root of the mind, the essence of the mind, is nothing but that I thought. When that I thought dissolves, there is no mind at all. In fact, it's not even, sometimes that state is described as manonasa, the destruction of the mind. But even that is just a way of expressing it. From the point of view of the mind, yes, it's the destruction of the mind. But Bhagavan says, actually, if you investigate the mind, investigate the ego, you'll find there's no such thing at all. So it's not a state of perfect calmness of mind, it's a state of complete and utter absence of mind. Not that the mind was there at one time and has been destroyed, the mind was never there. So we cannot talk about that state. That state is beyond the mind. So we cannot talk about that state. What we can talk about is trying to practice this in order to reach that state. It's not a state to be reached because it's already here and now. But from the perspective of the mind or ego, it is something to be reached. It's something we are striving towards. We're trying to know what we actually are. So while practicing, we are still taking, we're still experiencing this body as I. So we are still, in order to maintain this body, a certain amount of attention is needed. We need to do some work, we need to do some things. So none of us are attentive to ourselves alone throughout the day. We are attentive to other things. We have to eat, we have to answer the calls of nature, we have to have bath, we have to do so many things. So all these activities go on, but in the midst of all of these activities, whatever else may be happening, we are always self-aware. So it's up to us how much we want to allow our attention to dwell on other things, how much we want to allow our attention to dwell on ourselves. Our aim when we're practicing this, we cannot just force ourselves to be self-attentive all the day. We, as Bhagavan said, we have to slowly wean the mind away from its taste in wandering. Bhagavan used to give the analogy of a cow that has run away from its shed. It's found some nice green grass, and it's happily munching away on the green grass. Bhagavan said, all other types of spiritual practice is like taking a stick and trying to chase the cow back to its shed. Whereas in Atma-vichara, we are not forcing them. We slowly, slowly tempt the mind back to its back to the heart, back to its source. So we've got to, and there's a beautiful verse in Bhagavad Gita, which Bhagavan has translated into Tamil. The verse begins in Sanskrit with the word sane sane. Sane means slowly, gently, softly. Softly, softly, gently, gently, slowly, slowly, we've got to fix the mind in ourselves. Yes.
You know that Atma-vichara from the Maharishi advocated very much.
Yes.
At the same time, he said that a lot of people went back to him and asked him, "We couldn't do it, Ramaharishi, what can we do?"
Yeah.
So he said, the Vedic ways, which I want to know from you because you're a well-read man, is whether he said about the sakshi, witnessing, or later on he said people are able to. He advocated self-surrender. The self-surrender is a surrender to your divine life within yourself, or which I didn't understand very much. Can you explain it?
Bhagavan sometimes said there are only two ways. Either investigate yourself or surrender yourself. But though he said it's two ways, he made it very, very clear that actually they are one and the same. But you know Tamil, don't you? Bhagavan has said, expresses it very, very clearly in Nanya. In one sentence, Bhagavan defines what is self-surrender. Anma chintane tavira, vera chintane kalamba vadaku, satram idam kodamal, atmanishta paranai iripade, tane isanaku alipadam. For those who don't understand Tamil, atma-chintane means thought of oneself, literally. Chintane means thought, but in effect it means self-attentiveness. So accept self-attentiveness. Vera chintane kalamba vadaku satram idam kadama, not giving even the slightest room to the rising of any other thought except self-attentiveness. That is an adverbial clause. The main clause is atmanishta paranai iripade. That's the main subject. Being as atmanishta paran. Atmanishta paran means one who is firmly fixed in oneself. So being one who is firmly fixed in oneself, giving not even the slightest room to the rising of any thought other than the thought of oneself, tanne isanaku alipadam, that is giving oneself to God. So the nature of the ego, The ego, as Bhagavan says in verse 25 of Ulunaptu, urupatri undam, urupatri nikkum, urupatri undu miha ongum. That is, grasping form, it comes into existence. Grasping form, it stands. Grasping and feeding on form, it flourishes. So the nature of ego, what does Bhagavan mean by form? He describes the ego there as uruvatrapeya hande, the formless phantom ego. So the ego has no form of its own, but it grasps form. So any form that it grasps is something other than itself. That means it grasps phenomena. The first phenomenon it grasps is a body. It doesn't, no phenomena exists there independent of ego, because as he says in the next verse, when the ego comes into existence, everything comes into existence. So the ego rises, projects phenomena, and it grasps this first phenomenon of the body as I, and then through the five senses, it's constantly grasping other things. How is the ego grasping? It's a formless phantom. It's got no arms or legs. So how does it grasp form? It grasps them in its awareness. By being aware of anything other than itself, that is how the ego comes into existence. And by being aware of other things, it stands. That means it continues its existence. And grasping and feeding on forms, that things other than itself, it flourishes. So the food that sustains the ego is attention to anything other than itself. So how is the ego to give up itself? So long as it holds on to anything else, even if it's has great devotion for a particular name and form of God. So isn't it got devotion for Arunachala or for Shiva or for Rama or Krishna or Jesus or Buddha or anything. It's got great devotion. So long as it's clinging to any external form, it is sustaining itself. So if we truly want to surrender ourselves to God, doesn't matter whether we call our God Allah or Buddha or Jesus or Shiva, Rama, Krishna, anything. It doesn't matter the name we give it. If we want to surrender ourselves to God, we have to let go of everything, including the outward name and form of God. And how to let go of everything? Because the nature of the ego is grasping. It has to grasp something. So it has to grasp itself. But can it grasp itself? There's nothing to grasp. So if it tries to grasp itself, it subsides and disappears. That's why Bhagavan says, Tedinal otum pidicum. If it seeks itself, it disappears, takes flight.
So it goes on inquiring.
We have to turn our attention more and more back towards ourself. That will lead to the dissolution of the ego. That Bhagavan says in verse 26, he says that is giving up everything. It's giving up the ego and it's giving up everything that comes along with the ego. So actually self-inquiry and self-surrender are the same thing. We can understand from this, in no sastra is it ever recommended witnessing as a practice. This is a misinterpretation. The word sakshi, witness, is used in scriptures in slightly different senses in different contexts. What witnesses all this, according to Bhagavan, is the ego. So in a sense, the ego is a witness. And the reason why it's sometimes said that the ego is described as a witness is now the nature of the ego is to identify itself. It identifies itself with this body, it identifies itself with the mind. When we are trying to separate ourselves from these things, it is said, you are not this body, you are not this mind, you are that which is aware of these things, you are the witness of these things. So in other words, we try to separate ourselves, because first we have to separate the ego from everything else before we can cling to the ego alone. So what we are trying to cling to is to the witness, to that which is aware of all these things. If we are aware of all these things, if we are so-called witnessing, we are attending to things other than ourselves, we're feeding the ego. If we want to dissolve the ego, we have to cling to the witness alone. Give up the witness, hold on to the witness. That is the significance. What?
We leave it to Atma to witness.
No, Atma doesn't witness anything except itself. Because in Atma's view, Atma in the sense of Atma Swarupa, our real nature, is pure self-awareness. It's not aware of anything else. That which is aware of anything other than itself is only the ego. Our aim is to be aware of, is to hold on to the ego alone. So we have to hold on to the witness. We don't have to witness anything. We have to isolate the witness, separate the witness from all that is witnessed, and hold on to the witness alone. That will lead to the dissolution of the witness, and what will then remain is pure self-awareness, which is a witness of nothing except itself, because it alone exists.
Another thing, Paul Brinton was still in quite a few times, 1934.
Yeah.
In his third talk, Paul Brinton asked a lot of questions to Mr. Ramamurthy.
Yes.
He said very difficult for you to do that. He said, you carry on, doesn't matter, and then you develop like electric current you feel in yourself. If you go on doing it, electric current will carry on for a lifetime. That I didn't understand. What's the current?
Yeah. Bhagavan sometimes used to talk of a current of self-awareness. That is, we are always self-aware, but generally we are negligently self-aware. Negligent self-awareness is what is called pramada, self-negligence, because we're more interested in attending to other things. If we cultivate this habit of being self-attentive, the more we cultivate it, we will be aware of the self-awareness like a flow. It's not really a flow, because self-awareness doesn't, there's nowhere for it to go. But because we're still experiencing time, we experience it as a continuous, the more we cling to it, the more we're aware of its continuity. Its continuity is expressed by flow. In verse 7 of Upadesha Undia, Bhagavan talks about meditation. He says, rather than meditation which is interrupted, meditation which is uninterrupted, like the flow of ghee. So that is what is meant by that flow. It's the continuity, it's the unbroken self-awareness. That is what is called a flow or a current. Bhagavan may have said it's like an electric current. I doubt he would have said that, but it's we have to go beyond the words to what is meant. It's talking about that flow, that constant underlying self-awareness. It is always there. But when we practice being attentive to that, practice being attentively self-aware, we will begin to experience it as an underlying flow. So even in the midst of our other activities, even when it's necessary for us to attend to other things, we'll be aware of the background self-awareness, like a flow. Yes.
I think I've noticed a sort of slightly depressive sadness that comes along during the day. Over the years of doing self-inquiry, I don't have this Satchitananda that's spoken of. It seems to be sort of poignancy all the time.
Yes.
Like a sadness. Like a grief. And I don't know if that's just thought.
Well, all grief, all sadness is a thought. It's a product of thought. We in sleep, when there's no ego, there's no sadness.
Yeah.
When the ego rises, according to Bhagavan, when the ego rises and attends to anything else, that is dukkha. Dukkha can be translated as suffering or misery, but it has a broader meaning than that. There's dissatisfaction.
Yeah.
We are never satisfied. There's always a niggling dissatisfaction. Even if we get all that we want, the moment we get what we want, we are happy.
Yes.
But the next moment, we're still not satisfied. So that dissatisfaction is the nature of the ego. So long as the ego is there, there will be that background dissatisfaction.
It's a sort of pervasive.
Yes, yes.
I can't even put it into words. And it's a feeling that's so
yes.
Now, that almost don't notice it.
Yes, yes. But the more we investigate ourselves, the more we will be aware of the very nature of the ego is that that dissatisfaction. So the very nature of the ego is dukkha. It is not happiness.
Well, like you said earlier about the causal body.
Yes.
And there was a darkness.
Yes.
It's a word I like very much. It's like a shadow inside of you.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
It's very abstract.
Yes.
It doesn't have form.
Yes.
And it sort of pervades everything.
Yes.
But
the way to go beyond that is to look back at the light. That you, without light, you cannot be aware of darkness. I'm not talking now about physical light. I'm talking about without the light of awareness, we can't be aware of either physical darkness or even spiritual darkness. In Christian mysticism, there's a book written by a medieval monk called The Cloud of Unknowing, and they talk of the dark night of the soul. But in order to know that state of unknowing, in order to know that dark night of the soul, we must be aware. So we are the light. So in order to pierce through that darkness is now, the darkness never hides the light, but it obscures the light. We are self-aware, but we are not aware of ourselves as we actually are. So in order to eradicate the darkness, we need to be aware of ourselves as we actually are. We need to pierce through that darkness. We can pierce through it only by looking back at the source of the light, which is ourself. Only by self-attentiveness. But until we actually go beyond that, until we merge back into our source, until we're completely dissolved, until we're completely eradicated, we will experience ourselves as this ego. And as this ego, we are dissatisfied. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa said, dissatisfaction is the proof that you are Brahman. Because our nature is infinite bliss, we cannot be satisfied with anything less than that. And the fact that we're always dissatisfied, whatever we achieve, we're always looking for something more. That is because our real nature is Brahman, and we cannot be satisfied with anything less than our real nature.
Yeah, you say that, Michael, but it's not offering us much, is it? You're actually saying it's beyond description. You're pointing out that all the things that we really want, we think are going to give us happiness, like family life, the beauty of nature.
Yeah.
All that is somehow doesn't deliver the goods.
Yeah.
You can take a powerful drug, LSD or something, see all sorts of wonderful things.
Yeah.
But it's ultimately unsatisfactory.
Unsatisfactory.
But what Bhagavan does, and you do as well, is offer us, you're dangling something there, and you're not even giving us one iota of what it is, and you're just saying,
Bhagavan has said very clearly what it is. You are that.
Yes,
it is you.
My experience of myself is not anything,
right,
anything to go for.
Right.
Like Woody Allen said, I want to be somebody else. I don't want to be me.
I've only one regret in my life, to be somebody else.
I know a young teenager saying exactly, she wanted to change her name. She just wanted to be somebody else. She was so miserable being herself.
Yeah.
Jessica.
Yeah.
She wasn't particularly popular at school. You know, so...
Yeah.
give us something.
Well, there's nothing to give. Bhagavan cannot give you what you already have. All Bhagavan can do, even Bhagavan is powerless to give you that. All he can do is say, look within, it's there already, you are that.
Michael, there is one fact that while Ramana was alive,
yes,
he was bringing to realization many people. But after he died, there was nothing happening.
Bhagavan died, did he? Bhagavan is dead.
No. No, I mean the presence of Bhagavan was.
When Bhagavan's body was about to die and everyone was weeping, Bhagavan said, where can I go?
But in fact, no, this is a question. Where other people realizing the self after he died? Question mark. I don't know.
There's only one person who can realize the self. There's only one ego. So only one person can realize the self. And that even that person cannot, because when that person, it's not the person who's going to realize the self, it's not even the ego who says that person is I. The dissolution of the ego is what is called realization of the self. Bhagavan, sometimes when people used to talk about jnanis, whether so-and-so is a jnani, so-and-so is a jnani, Bhagavan used to say, there is only one jnani, and you are that. We cannot find a jnani outside ourselves. The only jnani we can find is within ourselves.
Yeah, but some people became jnani.
No. To be a person and to be a jnani is a contradiction in terms. There's no such thing as a self-realized person. Because if you are self-realized, you're not a person. If you're a person, you're not self-realized. The dissolution of the ego, who is the source of the person, the root cause of the appearance of a person, that ego has to dissolve. When the ego dissolves, there is no person to be self-realized. Because we are so soaked in our self-ignorance, we keep on trying to impose our self-ignorance upon our understanding of what is jnana. That's why Bhagavan said, there are no jnanis, there's only one jnani, and that is you. You cannot find any jnani anywhere except in yourself, because you yourself are that, and there is no other. So long as there appear to be others, there's no jnana. The very appearance of others is ajnana.
I just want to ask you, what happened when Bhagavan was putting one hand on the head of the person, another hand on the heart of the person, and then there was a...
In whose view did all that happen? Hmm? When Bhagavan was asked about it, Bhagavan said, in whose view did all that happen? And somewhere it is said, or in the case of Paraniswami, it didn't work. Someone is recorded in books like that. Bhagavan said, who said it didn't work? What do you expect to work? So all this is because we take ourselves to be the body, we see everything in terms of bodies. Our view is a very, very gross view. And so long as we have this gross outward-facing view, there's no jnana. Well, the jnana is already there, but we seem to be unaware of the jnana. The only way to experience jnana is to turn within. And that doesn't require the physical presence of Bhagavan, it requires the real presence of Bhagavan, because Bhagavan is always present in us as I. So long as we're looking for Bhagavan's presence outside, that's why Bhagavan said so many times, I am not this body. I was just telling someone, there was a devotee called Janaki Mata. Once she came to the ashram, she was a great devotee of Bhagavan, and apparently she saw so many visions, so many ecstatic experiences she had. Once when she came to Bhagavan, came to the ashram, she saw Bhagavan was coming from the gosala, the cowshed. I was slowly walking back, and there were not many people around. She thought this is a very good opportunity. So she went up to Bhagavan, she prostrated before him and held his feet. And Bhagavan looked down at her and said, "What are you doing?" She said, I'm holding on to the feet of my guru." Bhagavan said, "These are not the feet of your guru. These feet are perishable. If you cling to these feet, you will not achieve anything. If you want to achieve that which is imperishable, you have to cling to the real feet of a guru, which is what is shining in you as I. Cling to those feet. Those feet alone will save you." So we always want to give importance to Bhagavan's physical presence. Bhagavan is always trying to get us to see that his real presence is in us, ever present as I. And that is the only, if we understand that, will we be able to follow his path and achieve the salvation we're seeking. It can be found outside. All that we see, well, the very purpose of Bhagavan appearing in the human form was to tell us, everything you seek is within you. You are that. Turn within, see yourself. That's all there is to it.
So there are not other people who are who achieve realization and other...
In a dream, supposing you're speculating in a dream, is this person realized, is that person unrealized? It may seem to you real in a dream, but so-and-so is realized, so-and-so is unrealized. When you wake up from a dream, you'll understand it was all meaningless. All the other people you see are a projection of the ego. Even the person you seem to be is a projection of the ego. So no person can be self-realized. The dissolution of the ego, which is what projects all person, that is self-realization. And that is always present. You are already that. It's not something to be newly achieved.